thanks to the ingenuity of Mr. Rodriguez, it looks like we will have the presentation. Look at that, it is going to come up there. Hopefully we'll get it right. We're still fiddling a little bit with the image, but our topic tonight is a fascinating one. We're going to look at the life and works of Rabbi Schneur Zalman of Liadi, a very important individual who is the founder of the Chabad Hasidic movement. The only tricky thing is I don't have an image of it. So I'll have to turn around and look backwards as I do this. Okay, I have a feeling this one is not going to Latvia, but hopefully you will enjoy it tonight. Oh, look at that, making progress. We got some color there, right? Okay, so now you're going to have to push the little arrow button to go to the first slide.
Okay.
Okay.
Which arrow button is that?
The arrow button on the right-hand side that you don't see. Just touch the right-hand, no, no. Just touch the right-hand side of your screen. There we go. Okay, we're moving, and it's blank. Touch it again. Okay, there we go. Here he is, the Alter Rebbe. Touch it twice more, please, and then stop. Okay, so the figure we're looking at, this is the iconic image of him. I'm sure you've seen it in so many other representations. In fact, one of the fascinating aspects of the Chabad movement, which is fundamentally a modern movement, it's an 18th century movement, is that they were one of the earliest Jewish movements to really capitalize on the iconic value of imagery. And one of my colleagues at Touro College in New York wrote a brilliant thesis on the visual culture of Chabad, in which they really capitalized on the power of having a physical image of a particular Rebbe or a symbol, logos, and so on to carry their message across. This is a very famous image of our subject tonight, very ethereal kind of expression, looking upwards to the sky, very saintly kind of image, the long beard and so on. And what I find especially fascinating is we happen to have in this synagogue a direct descendant of the Alter Rebbe. Would you please show us a picture of him, Mr. Rodriguez? There he is, Rabbi Aryeh Citron, who is a phenomenal Talmud Chacham. He's the one of the main Baalei Korah here, who reads the Torah. And as you can see from this image, he looks a lot like his ancestor. The same kind of shape of face and beard and the kind of the upraised eyebrows. I really enjoy seeing the two of them together. Just put the plus, touch one more time. There we go. Rabbi Aryeh Citron. So you can, and he's also, by the way, a very refined person with very, very gentle and sophisticated characteristics. His interpersonal relations are great. So you can really see the echoes of the Rebbe in this descendant. But that's our topic for tonight. His years are, of course, 1745 to 1812, a period of tremendous change in, you got to do both things, right? One hand on the camera, one hand there. By the way, shout out to Latvia. I was going to show everyone the statistics on Latvia lately, but the 19th century, the turn of the 19th century, when the Rebbe lived, was an extremely complex and difficult time politically for that period, for that part of the world. And Jews were caught up in some of the most significant geopolitical events of several hundred years. Give us a next slide, please. The most significant element to begin with were the partitions of Poland. Poland was an independent country at this time, but it was very weak. They had a remarkably democratic form of government with the rather absurd librarum veto that allowed the government to be kept at a standstill based on the will of a single individual in the large chamber called the same, and they were paralyzed with indecision largely because of their commitment to respect the will of every single nobleman who had a position in the government. As a result, the three far more powerful neighbors of Poland, that is to the west, Germany, to the southwest, Austria, and to the east, Russia, so depicted here, you see Catherine the Great on the left and the Austrian and German officials, they simply decided to carve up Poland between the three of them. Largely without much violence, they simply said, Poland is too weak to exist. We will each take a chunk of Poland for our own countries. Next slide, please. So you can see that Poland here was successively divided in three three partitions, which removed the Jews from Polish control, where they had lived with great peace and harmony from the 12th century until the 18th, and suddenly gave Russia the world's largest single concentration of Jews, which was great for the availability of Chinese food, but was a tremendous challenge to the Russian government, because they had, since 1479, declared the entire country Judenrein, free of Jews, and so they had to come up with a lot of legislation to learn how to cope with this massive influx of Jews. Yes, Judith.
I'm sorry, but because of my short sight availability, the Russians carving up Poland.
Yes.
Were they and taking this large concentration of Jews?
Mm-hmm.
And a question is why. Did they take that particular segment? If you're carving it up, why take what you didn't want?
So it's obvious. They took the part that was geographically closest to them.
Yeah.
So they moved from Russia westward. Well, that's why. So it would not make sense for Russia to take, you know, the Congress Poland way over here at first.
I could see why they took it up to the...
Everybody takes as much as they can.
Could.
Yeah.
Was it particularly fertile farmland?
To the south, yes. This is Ukraine, breadbasket of Europe. So the right bank of the Dnieper is also very heavily populated by Jews. They're running the latifundia for the Polish noblemen and so on. So it's an interesting time. And in another context, I would talk more about the politics of it. Catherine II was an unusual tsarina who decided to extend a tremendous amount of rights to Jews at the time. But for the Jews living there, and our specific topic, but just understand that it's a tremendous political shift, great political change at the time. One more big change. Go ahead. I'm pointing at you. That means, yeah, you've got to operate. Of course, this is the area of the Napoleonic invasion of Russia. This is a picture showing Napoleon in retreat. Russia eventually defeats the French invasion. They had a brilliant soldier known as General Winter. France overcommitted itself to the invasion of the massive territory, and were simply under the scorched earth policy that the Russians use. They trapped the French army, and they starved as they tried to retreat out of the country. And all this happened within the context of the Rebbe's life, and he's trying to articulate a revolution that is just as impressive within Judaism at the same time. I'll pause on the questions. I'm starting late, so I think I'm going to talk a little more first. So let's understand, first of all, place them in context. Rabbi Schneur Zalman of Liadi is one of the most prominent Hasidic leaders. He's in the crucial third generation leadership, which follows from the Baal Shem Tov. Let's zoom in on the Baal Shem Tov, please, for a second. So the Baal Shem Tov is an interesting figure. If you go on the website, you'll see I've got a lecture on him alone. But just to speak about him for a few moments to place it in context, he was an itinerant preacher from southwestern Ukraine, southern Poland, and he advocated a broadcasting of Kabbalistic doctrines to the relatively uneducated masses of Jews living in the impoverished, intellectually impoverished regions of Ukraine and Poland. He was called the Baal Shem Tov. His real name was Israel ben Eliezer. He was called the Baal Shem Tov because there was a large movement of popular religious practitioners called Baalei Shem. That's a plural. Baal Shem is the singular. And what that essentially means in English is an amulet maker. A person would have a difficulty, and we're talking now about a region where there are not a lot of yeshivas, not a lot, the center of Talmudic scholarship is far away in Lithuania. You would have a problem with your business, with your marriage, trying to find a shidduch, trying to have a baby, all kinds of things. You would go to one of these itinerant preachers, and you would pay a certain amount of money, and they would write for you a handwritten amulet, usually invoking the names of various angels and Kabbalistic discussions, and you would take that amulet, you would put it under your bed, or put it in your hat band, or put it in different places, and it would be like a segula. It would be kind of like a Lahavdil, a good luck charm kind of thing, and it was like a very, very popular thing that Jews did, and still do to this day. If you go to any Judaica bookstore, you'll see that they'll have little laminated cards. You know, if they have 100 of them, then 90 of them are for Parnassa, and the other 10 are for everything else. But that's what Jews do, such things. And of course, the hand, you know, with the eye in the middle, it's all in that same family of activity. However, as you can imagine, a lot of these Baalei Shem were not especially reputable. Snake oil salesmen who were making a living by, you know, cheating people through various devices. And these segulot were not considered worthwhile at all. By the way, the tradition goes all the way back into the Talmud of using such amulets. Kameot is the Hebrew or Aramaic term. And there's a distinction drawn really from the earliest sources between kameot that are effective and may be used, and others that are just, you know, garbage, and it's a waste of time and money and inappropriate. So, as they say in Yiddish, plus ça change, plus la même chose. In the 18th century, you have a lot of people who are selling these things, but one of them stood out above the rest. That was the Baal Shem Tov, right? The good Baal Shem, who was known to be highly intelligent, known to be highly learned, known to be deeply spiritual, and his amulets were considered far more efficacious. He eventually rose to a position of some prominence in the town of Medjibush. Now, let's go on one more. The Baal Shem Tov, or acronym is Besht, died approximately the year 1760. He had several disciples, the most significant of which, in terms of carrying on the tradition of leadership and inculcating future students, was the Magid of Mezrich, who died in 1772. The Magid left behind five principal students who, in their own way, set five distinct paths of Hasidic thought. And we'll explain what Hasidic thought is briefly. But of those five students, the one who is our subject is the youngest of them, Rabbi Schneur Zalman of Liadi. So that's essentially placing him within the chain of Hasidic tradition. The Baal Shem Tov is considered the founder of this movement. The Magid is his principal student. And then of the five principal students of the Magid, we have Schneur Zalman. Okay. Now, this is placed within the context of the so-called misnagdim, or opponents. So-called because they opposed the innovations that Hasidism represented. The misnagdim, of course, did not have that name until the Hasidic movement existed, such that they could oppose it. Otherwise, they were known as Litvaks, or Lithuanians, who are also known, as I think I've told you in the past, for their cold rationality, their wry sense of humor, their superior fashion sense, and a few other elements which are specifically associated with the northern Lithuanian Jews. Their greatest leader was the Vilna Gaon, shown here. I think if you zoom in, you can touch the thing. There we go. The Vilna Gaon, Rabbi Eliyahu Kramer of Lithuania, a genius who died in 1797. He was some 25 years older than our subject, Rabbi Schneur Zalman, and they had a significant amount of debate that was conducted primarily in the press and primarily by their students. Despite the wishes of the younger Rabbi Schneur Zalman for an open discussion with the Vilna Gaon, this never occurred. And in fact, if you look in Hasidic literature, you'll often find, for example, on the back of the books, when they chronicle the life of Rabbi Schneur Zalman, they'll say, you know, another invitation rejected by the Vilna Gaon. And Rabbi Schneur Zalman tries to meet the Vilna Gaon. He says, no, it's a turning point to be rejected by the Vilna Gaon. Is oicha groisa zach, also a great thing. So when the Hasidic movement really got underway in the last couple of decades of the 18th century, the Lithuanians, the traditional Talmudic Jews, had several points of contention against the Hasidic movement. Very, very severe and nasty debates, which are, I think, really unparalleled for most of Jewish history. It's very rare that you have debates that are this hot for this long. And let's talk about the issues. So some of the issues were, first of all, a great fear that the Hasidic movement represented a resurgence of the Sabbatean movement. You'll recall in the 17th century, Shabbatai Tzvi proclaimed himself the Messiah, also a brilliant Talmudist and Kabbalist, but mentally unstable, you know, believed that, you know, he could levitate, believed that, you know, he had supernatural powers, and he garnered a remarkably large following. Perhaps in part because of the demoralizing factors of the Khmelnytsky rebellion that occurred about a dozen years earlier, but so many Jews were completely taken up with Shabbatai Tzvi's message, and they felt, this is it, the Geula has finally occurred, we are going to be redeemed, we're going back to Israel. And when he finally presented himself to the Ottoman Sultan and said, I'd like to have Israel back now because we're going to inhabit it and initiate the Messianic Age, the Sultan offered that he should either have his head removed or he should convert to Islam, which Shabbatai Tzvi promptly did. And that was the end of the movement, except for a small portion of Jews who decided to follow him into Islam, constituting a separate sect known as the Dunmeh, who exist right up to the 20th century. At any rate, Shabbatai Tzvi's shadow extended far into the 18th century, as many Jews were worried that his doctrines of Kabbalah were quite noxious, corrosive, dangerous to the traditional status quo. Figures none lesser than, for example, none greater than the Ramchal, Rabbi Moshe Chaim Lutzato, were influenced by Shabbatai Tzvi, but unfairly accused of seeking to promote Shabbatai Tzvi's agenda, and were pursued as a result of the fact that they read some of the books associated with the Sabbatean movement. So the Lithuanians felt that perhaps this Hasidic movement, its tremendously populist attitude, its reliance on, you know, magical aspects of Judaism, certainly the entire mystical tradition, which heretofore had been reserved only for the elite scholars, they felt that this represented a very dangerous breach in the wall of traditionalism and would ultimately bring a downfall of the Jewish people. But more specific elements of contention involve the antinomian attitudes of the Hasidic movement. Antinomian means against the law. Nomos is like law or norm. And there's so many ways in which the Hasidim deviated from standard norms. To give you a couple of examples, traditional Lithuanian Judaism, I'll ask a question to the group here. When you're studying Talmud, there's always one question that comes before anything else. Whatever subject you're studying in traditional Lithuanian Talmud, there's one question that comes up first. What is that question? I'll give you an example. It says you have to fast on Yom Kippur. What's the first question?
Why?
Never. No, the Talmud doesn't ask why.
How long?
Excellent. That's it. What is the shiur? What is the measurement? You say you have to fast on the Yom Kippur. Okay, how long is Yom Kippur? When is Yom Kippur? What does fasting mean? Am I allowed to have a sip of water? Am I allowed to have like a pill? Does intravenous feeding? We want to know the shiur, the measurement of it. That's the first question the Talmud asks. Never why. It says, okay, we have this mitzvah to do. How long is it? How big is it? Who has required? Who's not required? Etc. That's really, the Talmud is all about that question. So one of those big issues is we have to pray three times a day. And so we define those times of prayer, morning, afternoon, and evening prayers, Shachris, Mincha, Maariv. You recall the joke about the first three clergymen in outer space, right?
Yes.
Good. Okay, so I won't repeat it. Okay. I want to repeat it, but I won't. You know, it's a joke therapy. Anyways, so one of the things is the traditional Lithuanians are very makbid, particular on times of prayer. So much so that, you know, they used to take out their iPhones and they would open up their apps and they would say, for example, let's look at today's Zmanim. They get their little Siddur app, right? I remember when I was one of the first people to have a Siddur on my Trio, which is like a primitive iPhone from the 20th century, if you recall those. And I was once at a conference and I was praying from my phone and people thought that was weird. Then it started to ring. my sitter's ring. So here we go. The earliest time you can put on Talis and Tefillin now is 6:15 and 28 seconds in the morning. The latest time you can say the Shema prayer, according to the Magen Avram, is 9 hours, 11 minutes, and 55 seconds into the day. The latest time you can put on tefillin is 10 o'clock and 19 minutes, 35. Like, we're really big into these times. That's a really traditional Lithuanian way to be. You have to pray within these windows of opportunity. The Hasidim said, no, that's ridiculous. You know, you drag yourself out of bed in the morning, you're still hungry, you're still groggy, you schlep all the way to Young Israel, you shuckle away, but no one's paying attention. All you're thinking about is breakfast and stuff like that. That's not the way to daven. The Hasidim said, what you should do, get a good rest, have a little bit of a bite to eat. That's another thing. The Ashkenazim traditionally don't eat before prayer, just drinking like coffee or tea to wake you up, but otherwise no. But you know, you're so hungry, you're going to be thinking about food in your daven. Better you should go to synagogue, settled of mind, even if it's later. You think God cares if it's later? He wants you to pray properly. And so, on the one hand, this represented kind of like a much more emphasis on the spirituality of prayer, but on the other hand, it's antinomian. It's a new time. You're setting up, these are not the rules, you know? You can't call it baseball if you shorten the distance between the bases. So there was a lot of argument about these things. The Hasidim would retort, if the point is to cut down the trees, give the woodsman a chance to sharpen his axe. Give him the opportunity to prepare his instrument so he can do the task properly. Two different points of view. Kosher slaughter. New technologies evolved that fed into this fight. For example, up until this point, slaughtering was done with cast iron knives. Right? You remember cast iron, those big pans and stuff like that? And it was a big deal to sharpen a cast iron knife. So shochtim used to basically put up with the fact that to get the knife sharp was a really, really hard thing. And so if it was a little duller, that was okay. Even though that might mean that when the animal's being slaughtered, it involves pressure on the neck, which normally would invalidate a slaughter, the fact is it's very, very hard to get it so sharp. In the 19th century, steel knives became available, which were far easier to sharpen. You know, our knives today are stainless steel. They're far easier to sharpen, which is much better. You can make it really sharp, and you don't have to press in the animal's neck. But the thing is, when they're that sharp, it's very easy for them to become damaged. And if the knife has the slightest nick in it, that tears the animal's neck and also renders the animal unkosher. So the Lithuanians wanted to stick with the old technology, the old knives. The Hasidim said, no, we're going to the new knives. And so all of a sudden you have a separate type of shechita called Hasidic shechita, Hasidic slaughter. An argument, we'll see, it has economic aspects. Another example, the attitude to learning, very important. Again, remember that in Lithuania, there is a huge emphasis on the meritocracy of learning, on the idea that everyone has an opportunity to gain status through Torah. You'll recall, I think I've said this not too long ago, there are three ways to get status in the Jewish community, right? What's the first way to get status?
Money,
always, right? Money works. Kesef yanes akol, says Koheles. Money answers everything. The second way to get status?
Marry well,
right? Or be born well, right? If you have lineage, yichus. If you have your important bobi and important zedi, so on, that's another. But the only way to get status, which is devoid of your own merits, possibly, is through learning. Or I shouldn't say it like that. The other way around. If you don't have money and you are not well born, then the only way to get ahead is through learning, which is what Jews did tremendously in Lithuania, but in southern Poland and in Ukraine, it was not happening. So this movement, the Hasidic movement, which was very populist, had charismatic rabbis who reached out to the people, and so many Jews felt, you know, I don't have to put the energy into learning, I should put my energy into attachment to my Rebbe. I'm going to be a very devoted follower of my Rebbe, he will do the learning for me, I will just do what he says. And that was one of the, oh, look at this, my computer might be starting up. No, it just shut down. Oh no, it's coming back. Oh well. Okay, so that, and the argument there was the Lithuanians were saying, no, you can't rely on the Rebbe, you have to be your own man in Torah. The Litvak said, as it were, what do I need a Rebbe for? I have a sefer, Why do I need a rabbi? I have a book. And the Hasidim said, what do I need a book for? I have a Rebbe. Now, the role of the Rebbe as a whole was also very complicated. Many of the Litvaks felt that the Rebbe acquired a kind of heretically inappropriate status for the average Chassid, and that the Hasidim regarded this Rebbe as almost angelic in nature, and that someone that you could pray to. This was definitely a perversion of Hasidic doctrine, but nevertheless, it was one of those issues that divided the two communities dramatically. So these are the kind of fights that are happening. There is an important, Mr. Rodriguez, economic aspect to it. There's always an economic aspect. We should recall that in the 18th century, most of Jews in this region lived within manor communities, manor towns that were owned by a Polish nobleman, and it was entirely possible for a person to buy the position of chief rabbi of the town. You could purchase it. You could actually simply put in a bid and say, if I get this job, then I will pay the nobleman X amount of dollars every month. Do you think it's worth it going over to the computer? No. Okay, so we'll stick with your, thank you for having your iPhone there, Mr. Rodriguez. And this meant that you would have, and now why would a rabbi want to do this? Why would a person who might not even be a rabbi, why would they want to do this?
Influence.
Influence, power, right? But even before that? Money. Thank you, Esabel. It's always money, right? The Abramson rule of history. Because they would then get a revenue stream from the kosher meat tax, from synagogue dues, from a whole host of things where a rabbi could, you know, he'd make an investment, get the position, then he's got the shtela, and he would collect all of these funds. What happens, however, if a rival charismatic populist Rebbe comes into town and all the people start saying, hey, you know what? I love you, Rabbi, but the truth is I become Hasidic and I daven at a later time and I can't go to your shul because, you know, it interferes with my davening time. And, you know, Rabbi, I love it that you've been producing kosher meat for us for so long, but I've decided I want to hold with Hasidic standards and use the steel knives. So what's going to happen to the synagogue dues? What's going to happen to the kosher meat tax and so on? It creates an alternative revenue stream that undercuts the traditional Lithuanian community. And so there's an economic element to the fight which contributes to its severity. Okay, we really have to go now to Rabbi Schneur Zalman, now that we've given you some of the context. As a youth, he was a traditional Lithuanian. In fact, he was known in the Hasidic world as the Litvak because he came from the Lithuanian cultural region. And as a youth, he exemplified many of the values of the Lithuanian style of Judaism by spending his time in rabbinic scholarship, in which he excelled. As a young man, he made probably the best decision of his life by marrying a rich woman named Sterna, who turned out to be exceptionally devoted to her husband. And after his conversion to the Hasidic movement, she stood by him despite the opposition of her parents. And there's quite a number of stories about Rabbi Schneur Zalman and as his parents tried to dissuade him from leaving the traditional Lithuanian fold. They would expose him to all kinds of privations to see if he would change his habits. And his wife nevertheless remained steadfast and supported him throughout, including some personal tragedies that they were endured in their own family. As a young man, he was exposed to the teachings of the Maggid of Mezrich, and he went to meet with the Maggid, and he spent some time in his court. And it was in this court of the Maggid of Mezrich that he was deeply impressed with the combination of two factors that are characteristic of Chabad Hasidut in particular. And that is, ironically, the combination of deep mysticism with a highly complex rationalism at the same time. Meaning, the Chabad system of Hasidic thought, which Rabbi Schneur Zalman of Liadi founded, combined the kind of Talmudic thinking that the Lithuanians were so strong on, and a fairly rigorous halachic background with the deep Kabbalah of the Arizal that suffused the movement. These combination of the rational and the mystical balanced through his thought is really what exemplifies Chabad. As he said in those early years about the reason why he decided to become Hasidic was that in Vilna, right, that's the center of Talmudic Judaism, in Vilna you are taught how to master the Torah. In Meserich, you are taught how to let the Torah master you. And in fact, a very beautiful statement, and it speaks to his emphasis on the concept of bitul, of self-nullification, the eradication of all arrogance by realizing how one is radically nothing. Complex and pervasive idea in Chabad thought. Mr. Rodriguez, thank you. Okay. Despite his youth, because again he was the youngest of the Magid's disciples, he rapidly rose to prominence because he had a lot of the characteristics that the young Hasidic movement was seeking. Specifically, he did not have any of the failings of many of the more enthusiastic Hasidic teachers of his era, in that he had a very solid grounding in Talmud, and he could literally debate with the best of the Lithuanians. That's why he often was requesting to even debate some of Hasidic doctrines with the great Vilna Gaon himself. These requests were rebuffed, but nevertheless, he had those kinds of skills that allowed him to communicate in the vocabulary of the era. He had significant organizational abilities as well, and as he traveled from place to place and attracted followers, he was a very charismatic teacher, he was asked to take greater and greater leadership roles within this fledgling movement. He, however, had ambitions to move to Israel, and one Passover in the year 1777, he decided that this is it. You know, he's now 32 years old, he decided he wants to make Aliyah to the Holy Land. And in fact, he left his town of Liozhna at the time and prepared to leave for Israel permanently. It's a long trip, however, and many of his followers went with him, constantly imprecating him to remain in Lithuania. Ultimately, they were successful, and it's fascinating to see that the kinds of things that the community was willing to do to keep him in their Daladamos, in their region, was essentially they volunteered as a community. Liozhna would house 100 students who were studying underneath him, meaning basically pay for their room and board, and now allowing 100 students to study under him absolutely gratis. This is before, we should recall, any of the modern yeshivot were set up. The first major yeshiva is Volozhin, which was established by the disciple of the Vilna Gaon, and that's the first time that you have any formal institutes of learning in modern Europe. Prior to that, you just had like kind of disciple circles where one rabbi would gather around him, what, 5, 10 students, to have a community commit to say, we will pay for 100 students, just bring them on. That's a rather amazing commitment. And ultimately, they convinced him that he should stay. He remained in Lithuania, and he took on a very high level of leadership. Okay, I think I've spoken really fast, so I can pause for a couple of questions. I'm sorry to keep you waiting for it.
Yeah. My question originally was with the map, where was the Pale of Settlement?
Oh, that's a good question. Shall we go back to the map for a well, actually, it's hard to do the... Yeah, it's probably hard to go to the map, but basically the Pale of Settlement, it had different boundaries, but just for those of you who may not be familiar with the term, when Catherine II took over all these Jews of Poland, she was faced with a lot of opposition within Russia. Especially the clergy said, we can't let these Jews in here. You took over this territory, very nice, you know, we'll have lots of pierogies, but how are we possibly going to deal with all these Jews? And they were advocating some kind of crazy solution to get rid of them. Meanwhile, merchants, like in Riga, for example, said, great, Jews, we love them. They're excellent for business, international contacts, they have numeracy, literacy, let's get them. So she effected a compromise solution that said that, okay, we will not allow the Jews into the old boundaries of Russia, meaning before 1772 with the first partition. We will restrict them to the new areas that we've conquered. And she also conquered a few areas in the war with Turkey that she added to the Pale as well. And they called this region, in Russian, it's just the region of settlement. In English, you have this strange word, Pale of Settlement. So it basically extended from halfway through Latvia in the north, cutting Latvia in half. So Latvian, so funny. Latvia actually has a part in this lecture. The reason I mention this is because for some reason, I'm very popular in Latvia. The internet. Okay, so cut Latvia in half. It included all of what we would call today Lithuania, although Lithuania as a political concept is very different from what Jews consider Lithuania. For Jews, Lithuania is a cultural area, kind of like New York extends well into New Jersey for Jews as well. Florida stops dramatically after Palm Beach County, right? Those kinds of things. So Lithuania is rather large. It includes all of Congress Poland, traditional Poland, and then right bank Ukraine, which would be the right bank of the Dnipro River, all the way over to the boundary of Galicia. There were islands in the Pale of Settlement that were also barred to Jews. For example, the city of Kiev was not within the Pale of Settlement. Jews were not allowed to live there. Only 60,000 lived there illegally, but that's how, no, those kind of things. So that's where the Pale of Settlement was. Riga was just barely in the Pale of Settlement. It was at the very top corner. Yes, Solomon. Liadi is in Belarus. Yeah, Belarus is also within the boundaries of geographic cultural Lithuania. Like my grandfather, my namesake, Henry Hillel, he was from Russia, but he was a Litvak, you know, because his place of birth was in cultural Lithuania, not in Western. Okay, let's go weiter then. Thank you. Now, what is Chabad Hasidus in a nutshell? The term Chabad is an acronym of the first three sfirot of the Kabbalistic Eitz Chaim, the Tree of Life. Let's just one more click and we'll zoom in on this. You'll recall this map. We talked about it a lot when we looked at Moshe Cordovero and we looked at the thought of the Arizal as well. This is basically, in a nutshell, it is the way in which God influences the world according to mystical thought in Judaism. Just very quickly, these three sfirot, Chokhmah, which is kind of like wisdom or intelligence, Bina, understanding, and Da'at are the top three. Keter is a different thing, meaning crown. I don't want to go into it, but these are considered the three elevated sfirot, the first three ways in which God, you know, descends into the world, so to speak, and they influence the lower six over here, which have a different distinction associated with the emotions in particular. So the first three, though, are known as the intellectual sfirot. They're mainly epistemological in orientation. What is your brain doing? How does thought work? And so that's why this movement, which is very rational, called itself Chabad, Chokhmah Bina Da'at. It's also known as Lubavitch because he was very active in the town of Lubavitch, but that's just a place name. I want to mention also, while we're at it, the lowest sphere, we'll come back to it, is called Malchut. Can I get a translation of that term, Malchut?
Kingship,
majesty, right? Sovereignty, from the word melech, king. And the fact that Malchut occurs at the very bottom is going to be very significant in Schneur Zalman's life. Malchut, unlike the other sfirot, is considered to be radically empty. It is like its emptiness is its perfection. And it receives the influence from all the other sfirot. Kind of like if you want to get a mirror, you want a mirror that has no personality, no defects whatsoever. You want the mirror to be an accurate reflection of your face when you're looking in the mirror. So too, Malchut is totally devoid of any influence. It just has what the others bring into it, and that is its strength. So let's return to that momentarily. It has kind of an ironic connotation. So he named his movement Chabad after these three sfirot. Can we go further? Here we go, yes. And he engaged in some very powerful publications. Question from Ms. Abramson.
I thought one of the major differences between the Pale of Settlement and the Pale of Kabbalah is that
was that Chabad says that they will learn through their Rebbe, not by the door of their Rebbe, and the Rebbe will do their learning. So why would he name his entire movement off of learning and studying if it's not based on every individual should be studying?
As always, a brilliant question, Ms. Abramson. The question, to rephrase it, is, you know, I characterized early Hasidism as being rather lax in the intellectual sphere, the traditional learning sphere. And that was not true of Chabad. That may have been true of the 18th century Hasidic movement as a whole, that placed more emphasis on, you know, non-intellectual spirituality, like verbringen, right? Like sitting around and singing songs and things like that. But the actual working through the meaning of the text is very much characteristic of Chabad Hasidut, and it's also very Lithuanian. Of the Hasidic movements, Chabad is definitely the one that's most committed to textual study. I'd also like to point out, since you reminded me, you know, Chabad is the outlier of all Hasidic movements. It's very difficult to generalize about Hasidism and include Chabad at the same time, because Chabad tends to take its own stance on so many key issues that renders it often at odds, sometimes even at physical odds, with actual rioting and fighting with other Hasidic groups. Like issues about, how do we relate to the state of Israel? Chabad is very pro-Israel, very involved in promoting the military and things like that, which is not something you see with most Hasidic groups. Think about a contrast, Naturei Karta, which is way on the other extreme. Chabad, again, like we see here, very committed to text, even in the 18th century, very committed to traditional Talmudic study, many of the other Hasidic movements not. That's changed over time, where Hasidic movements have adopted more Lithuanian standards as well, but Chabad stands out in there. Think about outreach, or kiruv, right? How often do you see, like, Satmar or Biala, putting up billboards on I-95, or, standing on the street corner outside public, excuse me, are you Jewish? That's just not a thing that the other Hasidic movements do. They tend to be far more insular, far more inward directed, and Chabad is radically out there. So Chabad is always the outlier compared to other Hasidic groups. We can't generalize from them. Okay, Solomon, last question, and we'll get back. Chabad definitely was involved in Kirov before, but the Rabbi Menachem Mendel Schneerson, with his Ufaratzta campaign and onward, he's definitely took it to a new level. The adaptation, everything we look at, the use of technology. How often have you seen an internet broadcast or a video broadcast from Satmar? It just doesn't happen. It's someone told me, I'm not sure it's true, but someone told me that there was a Satmar website that has in Yiddish on the top, why are you looking at this website? But I don't know if it's true. Someone said that. But okay. Anyways, major publications. Each of these publications had a really pronounced impact on intellectual thought. First, he rewrote a siddur for his followers. There are several different traditions in the prayer book. There's the Yemenite, there's a Sephardi, and there's an Ashkenazi prayer book. And there are minor differences even in key prayers like the Shemona Esrei, the 18 benedictions. And one of the innovations of the Chabad movement, which was really undertaken by Reb Schneur Zalman, was a shift from the traditional Ashkenazic nusach, or rite, to a nusach that was approved by the Arizal, the Kabbalist of Tzfat that we spoke about several weeks ago. So he edited a siddur, which we have copies of here, even though this is not a Chabad shul. There are many people who prefer to use that nusach. And so these are Ashkenazim who would normally use an Ashkenazic nusach, who migrated as well to this new edited version, which followed the nusach of the Ari. So this siddur probably has more of an impact than any other book, because it's used on a daily basis by so many Chabad Jews. But further to that, he wrote a code of Jewish law, which was strangely titled the Shulchan Aruch, which is the same title, of course, as Rabbi Yosef Karo's Shulchan Aruch. But it was it was the first major attempt to update the Shulchan Aruch to incorporate later opinions. The Shulchan Aruch, of course, is 16th century. Now we're 200 years later. A lot has been written, commentaries and so on. So this was an attempt to, in one big sect, kind of update it. Several important figures followed in this, including the Mishnah Brura of the Chafetz Chaim. But this seven-volume, what's the right word, condensation? Mr. I'm looking at you, Mr. Rodriguez, making it smaller. Contraction? Compilation?
Abridged?
It is essentially an abridged version of the Shulchan Aruch. It focuses, I'll show you the close-up soon, but it focuses on the section known as Orach Chaim, which is all about daily life, because it's designed for average, you know, Jews in their own homes to use. It has a very small section on Choshen Mishpat, and very, very little on issues of like marriage and divorce and things like that. That's left up for experts. But daily life, blessings, prayers, Shabbat, holidays, that has a large discussion. And it's very modern in its outlook for 18th century. And finally, the most influential was a remarkable work called Tanya. It's a popular name for it. It comes from the first word, which means simply, it was taught. And that's a term used very frequently within the Talmud. But basically, this is an amazing work which distills a lot of the Kabbalah of the Arizal into a format that is accessible to people who are not well-versed in Kabbalistic discussion. It is also known as the Sefer HaBeinonim, the Book of the Intermediate, in which he distinguishes early on that there are three basic classes of people, and two of them we're not going to talk about. There's a tzaddik, completely righteous individual, a rasha, a wicked person, not the subject of this book. We're talking about the people who are called beinonim, intermediates, and what he meant by that are people who basically are tempted to do the wrong thing and yet nevertheless manage to do the right thing. It is a massive book for people who want to be mention, a person who, if you want to be a mensch, this is the book to read, essentially. It talks about, you know, the various factors that pull a person's inclinations toward doing the wrong thing, strategies for overcoming those desires. It fits it within a much larger metaphysical format of why this happens within the world. There's a brilliant section on how to repent for prior mistakes. It's a very, very powerful work that includes both metaphysics, you know, Jewish mysticism, and Musar, personal ethical development, philosophy. It's an amazing work, an amalgam of many, many letters that he essentially wrote to his followers and then later worked up into a book format. It's a classic that is studied daily by Chabad Hasidim today, and they continue to find great depth and meaning in it. Let's go quickly through the next three pictures, please, Mr. Rodriguez. This is a quick close-up of the Siddur. The Tehillat Hashem is the English version as well. Let's go to the next one. There we go. Here's a picture of the Shulchan Aruch, and you can see here seven volumes. The last volume is essentially an index of the seven. The first four deal with daily life, and the other two deal with other miscellany, even though they should really be about the same size if it wasn't a true condensation. And then finally, the Tanya. This is a very interesting, accessible version of the Tanya. It's called Lessons in Tanya, which has an interwoven commentary written in the 20th century that is available in several languages in five volumes. The original Tanya, of course, is a single volume. Yes?
Are there other Tanyas?
There are various editions of the same book, but there's only one book called Tanya that I'm aware of. The controversies were very significant around his life, and these controversies were periodic in nature between the Misnagdim and the Hasidim, and they tended to erupt around publication dates, which is fascinating because when when Jews would publish a book, there would be a hoo-ha. You know, book publishing was still pretty new. It's true, it's a couple hundred years now since the Gutenberg Revolution has happened, but books are circulating, and books created like energy, and books created like people talking about ideas. The way people today talk about movies for like 15 minutes, back then a book could have years worth of discussion, as entire communities would be affected by a book. Their lives would be changed by these books. So the arguments that surfaced around the Tanya were very, very powerful. And added to that, there was a huge gray market of unauthorized editions of the Tanya. One of the things that developed in the early days of printing was the fact that once someone printed a book, then it was really easy for other people to simply print it themselves and sell it themselves. There was no concept of intellectual property rights as we have today. And so one of the things that you'll read at the very beginning of the Tanya is a pretty strong curse on people who sell this book if it isn't an authorized edition, because people would they would plagiarize it, and they would just rush through it, all kinds of mistakes and misleading things, and it got the Hasidim in a tremendous lot of difficulty. And there's a lot of problems from the perspective of traditional Talmudic Judaism around certain ideologies. For example, the problem of evil. Where does evil come from? What does evil represent in the universe? Chabad has a rather dramatically novel approach to it that many misnagdim felt was heretical even in the 18th century. It has now become much more well accepted and at least debatable to this day. But I'm not going to go into it because it'll take us another 15 minutes. What ended up happening, in 1797, the famed Vilna Gaon passes away. There is a couple of interesting misunderstandings that ensue immediately thereafter. Among Hasidim, there is a rumor that spreads throughout the Chabad community that the Vilna Gaon, on his deathbed, had recanted his opposition to the fledgling movement. And so that was cause for celebration. And at the same time, there was a traditional Beit HaShoeva, Simchat Beit HaShoeva celebration, when Jews normally would celebrate in the holiday of Sukkot. And so these two things together, the rumor that the Vilna Gaon had recanted, which ultimately he did not, and the fact that Jews were allowed to celebrate on the Simchat Beit HaShoeva, led to a rather raucous gathering in certain towns of Hasidim, which the Lithuanians felt was disrespectful to the memory of the Vilna Gaon. And in this kind of poisoned atmosphere between the Hasidim and the Mitnagdim, which, by the way, rarely was expressed by the leaders themselves, but frequently by their more energetic disciples, Rabbi Schneur Zalman was denounced to the Russian authorities, who had just taken over this territory not too long ago. The charge? Espionage and treason. Where do you get this idea, espionage and treason? Well, the espionage was because Rabbi Schneur Zalman was long a supporter of the Jewish community in Israel, which was that time under the Turks, the Ottoman Turks. And so he was regularly collecting money and sending it to a foreign hostile power. And so those detractors of Rabbi Schneur Zalman portrayed this to the Russian authorities as an act of treason. That was espionage, sorry. Treason was because, if you recall the diagram of the Eitz Chaim, and at the bottom we had Malchut, which represents sovereignty. And what was the characteristic of sovereignty?
Purity.
But why pure?
Empty.
Emptiness. Empty. Right. And they pointed to a whole bunch of things. Look, he says the king is meaningless. The king is empty. The czar means nothing because Malchut is only what you put into it. And they portrayed this Kabbalistic doctrine as some kind of treason, of kind of, an argument against the power of the king and the significance of the king. He was arrested with a lot of pomp and circumstance, and there was some really fascinating interrogations which involved arcane discussions of the Russian police with this rabbi on central Hasidic doctrine. Ultimately, after 53 days, they decided you know, not all these charges are baseless. We're wasting a lot of time. And they simply let him go on the 19th of Kislev, which is considered the birthday of the Chabad movement and is celebrated to this day among Chabad Hasidim as a great holiday. They do all kinds of interesting things, including, for example, the yearly study of Tanya begins with the rabbi's release from prison. Okay. Let's go to, now, let's bring ourselves to the rapprochement. Ms. Solomon, I don't want to keep you too late. I'll take your question right after the end. I'm almost done. I apologize. I'm going to go a little late because we had trouble with the computers. It's not so terrible. Now, what other, this fight between the Hasidim and the Lithuanians and the Misnagdim. By the way, the Hasidim, you know what they call Misnagdim? I kind of like this. Okay. Snags. Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah, I'm a snag, right? That's kind of a tone to it. I like it. Anyways, I wear that badge proudly, I guess. The rapprochement occurred between the Hasidim and the Misnagdim by the second decade of the 19th century. And the reasons for that are twofold. The first is, if you'll zip ahead, both groups realized that their fighting was so counterproductive, particularly in the face of a far greater threat coming from the West. Moses Mendelssohn, shown here, the father of the Haskalah, or Jewish Enlightenment, was advocating, well, not him personally, but his followers after him, were advocating all kinds of radical changes to Judaism that represented existential challenges to the things that Jews held dear. Like, for example, the Hasidim and the Misnagdim are arguing about whether or not to use steel knives to make animals kosher. And the Haskalah was saying, what's kosher? You know, let's have a cheeseburger. It was irrelevant to them, steel versus cast iron. Just go in there and have whatever you want because the kosher laws are irrelevant. The Hasidim and the Misnagdim are arguing about whether or not you can daven before 10:28 a.m. And the Misnagdim, the Maskilim in the West are saying, you know what, let's move Shabbos to Sunday. It'll be more convenient. So the challenges are so deep coming from the West that the Hasidim and the Misnagdim realize that their fairly petty differences were worth solving in the interest of what was going on in the West. And that was a far greater challenge that was beginning to make...
You're missing the subtitles.
What happened?
Oh, so my wife's looking for shirts, I guess.
Okay, I'll check it out when we edit this version. Okay, let's go to the next slide and shut this down. The second thing is that now that the debates, really the first significant ban and counterban between the Hasidim and the Misnagdim is already in the 1760s, I think. So they've been fighting for about 60 years now, and they finally realized, now this is like 2-3 generations of fighting, that, you know, Taka, we can actually learn from each other a fair bit. The Hasidim, you know, especially Chabad, learned a lot of the value of traditional study. The Misnagdim, for their part, realized that, you know what, maybe we have to give some Kabbalah to our students as well. And no less a figure than Rabbi Chaim of Volozhin, the principal student of the Vilna Gaon, published this amazing work, Nefesh HaChaim, The Soul of Life, which is essentially the same kind of book as Tanya. It achieves the same kind of goal of taking these esoteric, arcane, difficult Kabbalistic doctrines and saying, look, I can explain this much to you. Even if you're not 40, even if you're not married and have all the Talmud under your belt and things like that, you can learn this much Kabbalah. And this is widely studied in the yeshivot for youth, you know, usually post-high school. But it is essentially an attempt to use the Hasidic strategy of offering Kabbalah to the masses in a format that was consistent with Lithuanian teachings. There's so many other elements of cross-cultural fertilization between the Hasidim and the Misnagdim that today is often very difficult to identify the origins of it. So I won't give you any examples. Let's go to the legacy slide and we'll take it home, Mr. Rodriguez. Today, Chabad is, of course, one of the most prominent of the Chabad, of the Hasidic movements. It's certainly the most well-known outside of the Hasidic world, with over 4,000 branches of outreach throughout the world, something that dwarfs all of the other outreach movements like Eish HaTorah and Or HaSameach and so on. It's truly an amazing global phenomenon today. And so much so that for most of the population of the earth, they're more, if they're encountering Orthodox Judaism, it's far more likely that they will encounter Chabad than any other form of Orthodox Judaism, even though it is comparatively new as a movement. So I hope that this lecture gave you a little bit of insight into the origins of this movement, and I will tell you that even though I am a snag, I happen to gain quite a bit of a personal insight, and I benefit tremendously from the teachings of Chabad that I happen to study myself, and I would encourage you to look into them as well. Thank you for your attention, and speak to you next time.